This is Biotecnika, and you're listening to India's first life science podcast, The Voice of Biotecnika. News, views and reviews. Opinion and opinion makers. Policy critics and policy makers. Now all on one integrated biotech platform, The Voice of Biotecnika. Launched on Biotecnika's 12th birthday, The Voice of Biotecnika is going to be your voice. We will discuss the latest innovations, talk about the bright side of life science sector, and debate on the darkest side of research. Our experts will take you on a ride to the deepest secrets of life sciences. The Voice of Biotecnika, a weekly podcast released every week on Wednesday. So what are you waiting for? Listen to the podcast and voice your opinion too. Want to talk about something you think is relevant? Contact us today via email info@biotecnica.org.
Nobel Prize 2018, a success story and an inspiration. Hello everyone and welcome back to Biotecnica's very own podcast, The Voice of Biotecnica. I am Rashmi and I bring to you a lot of facts about the recent Nobel Prize awardees in the field of biosciences. Out of the six fields of Nobel Prizes awarded each year, the Nobel Prize given in the field of physiology or medicine involves the field of life sciences. This field has been awarded 108 times so far to 214 Nobel Laureates between the years 1901 and 2017. For the current year, the award has been announced on October 1st, 11:30 a.m. CEST. In order to know more, please stay tuned with us. And for now, let us have a look at the work done by Nobel Laureates in the past years. Last year, 2017, Jeffrey Hall, Michael Rosbach and Michael Young were awarded the Nobel Prize for their discoveries around the molecular mechanisms controlling the circadian rhythm. Now you must be wondering what the circadian rhythm is all about. It basically signifies our internal biological clock that helps us decipher between night and day, also regulates our sleep-wake cycle. The three brilliant minds together peeked behind the working of this miraculous system and explained how every organism adapts their biological rhythm to the Earth's revolution. Using mere fruit flies as model organisms, the Nobel Laureates isolated a gene that controls the normal daily biological rhythm. They showed that this gene encodes a protein that accumulates in the cell during the night and is then degraded during the day. Subsequently, they identified additional protein components of this machinery, exposing the mechanism governing the self-sustaining clockwork inside the cell, which we now recognize that the same principle functions in most other multicellular organisms, including us humans. With exquisite precision, our inner clock adapts our physiology dramatically through different phases of the day. The clock regulates functions such as behavior, hormone levels, sleep, body temperature, metabolism, etc. Our well-being is affected when there is a temporary mismatch between the external environment and our internal biological clock. Let me give you an example. When we travel across different time zones, we experience something that we call a jet lag. This is a mismatch. In 1984, Jeffrey Hall and Michael Rosbach, working in close collaboration at Brandeis University in Boston, with Michael Young at Rockefeller University in New York, succeeded in isolating the period gene. Jeffrey Hall, Michael Rosbach then went on to discover the PER, the protein that encoded by the period gene, accumulated during the night and was degraded during the day. Thus, PER protein levels oscillate over a 24-hour cycle in synchrony with the circadian rhythm. Now, the next key goal was to understand how such circadian rhythm would be generated and sustained. Jeffrey Hall and Rosbach hypothesized that the PER protein blocked the activity of the period gene. They reasoned that by an inhibitory feedback loop, per protein could prevent its own synthesis and thereby regulate its own level in the continuous cyclic rhythm. The model was tantalizing, but a few pieces of the puzzle were missing. To block the activity of the period gene, per protein, which is produced in the cytoplasm, would basically have to reach the nucleus, where the genetic material was located. Again, Hall and Rochebash had shown the per protein builds up in the nucleus during the night. But how did it get there? In 1994, Michael Young discovered a second clock gene, timeless, encoded by the TIM protein that was required for a normal circadian rhythm. In elegant work, he showed that when TIM bound to PER, the two proteins were able to enter the nucleus, where they blocked the period gene and through the inhibitory feedback loop. Such a regulatory feedback mechanism explained how this oscillation of cellular protein levels emerged, but questions lingered. What controlled the frequency of oscillations? Michael Young identified yet another gene, double time, encoded by the DBT protein, that delayed the accumulation of the PER protein. This provided insight into how oscillation is adjusted to more closely match a 24 cycle. The paradigm-shifting discoveries by Laureates established key mechanistic principles for the biological clock. During the following years, other molecular components of the clockwork mechanism were elucidated, explaining the stability and its function. For example, Laureates identified additional proteins required for the period gene as well as the synchronization with the biological clock. Now let's look one step behind. In the year 2016, Yoshinori Osumi was awarded the Nobel Prize for work around autophagy. The word autophagy originates from the Greek word auto, meaning self, and phagein, meaning to eat. Thus, autophagy denotes self-eating. Osumi's discoveries led to a new paradigm in our understanding of how cell recycles its content. His discoveries opened the path to understanding the fundamental importance of autophagy in many physiological processes such as adaptation to starvation or response to infection. Mutations in autophagy genes can cause diseases and can also be involved in cancer as well as neurological malfunctions. He used yeast cells as model. Yeast cells are relatively easy to understand and consequently they are often used as model for human cells. They are particularly useful for the identification of genes that are important in complex cellular pathways. But Osumi faced a major challenge. Yeast cells are small and their inner structures are not easily distinguishable under the microscope. And thus, he was uncertain whether autophagy even existed in this organism. Osumi reasoned that if he could disrupt the degradation process in the vacuole while the process of autophagy was active, then autophagosomes should accumulate within the vacuoles and become visible under the microscope. He therefore cultured mutated yeast lacking vacuolar degradation enzyme and simultaneously stimulated autophagy by starving the cells. The results were striking. Within hours, the vacuoles were filled with small vesicles that had not been degraded. The vesicles were autophagosomes, and Osumi's experiment proved that autophagy existed in yeast cells. But even more importantly, he now had a method to identify and characterize key genes involved in this process. This was the major breakthrough, and Osumi published his results in 1992. Osumi now took advantage of his engineered yeast strains in which autophagosomes accumulated during starvation. This accumulation should not occur if genes important for autophagy were inactivated. Also, we expose the yeast cells to chemical that randomly introduced mutations in many genes, and then he induced autophagy. His strategy worked. Within a year, his discovery of autophagy in yeast, Hosumi had identified the first genes essential for autophagy. In a subsequent series of elegant studies, the proteins encoded by these genes were functionally characterized. The results showed that autophagy is controlled by a cascade of proteins and protein complexes, each regulating a distinct stage of autophagosome's initiation and formation. Thanks to Hosumi and others, we now know that autophagy controls important physiological functions, whether cellular components need to be degraded and recycled. Autophagy can rapidly provide fuel for energy and building blocks for renewal of cellular components, and thus is very much essential for cellular response to starvation and stress. In 2015, there were two prizes awarded in the fields of physiology and medicine. The first was given to 2UU for working on therapy against malaria, and the second was awarded to William Campbell and Santoshi Omura for their work on discovering therapy against roundworm parasites. Now, to learn more about these amazing discoveries, please tune in to our next session of Biotecnica's very own podcast. Now, before we end, let us have a look at this year's greatest contribution benefiting mankind. There were a lot of tough competitors. To name a few, the mighty microbiome, the cancer virus hunters, the checkpoint inhibitors, etc. Our anticipations came to a rest on this October 1st when James P. Allison and Tasuku Unjo together received the award for their discovery of cancer therapy by inhibition of negative immune regulation. During the 90s, in his laboratory at University of California, Berkeley, James P. Allison studied the T protein CTLA-4. He was one of the several scientists who had made the observation that CTLA-4 functions as a brake on T cells. Other research teams exploited the mechanism as target in the treatment of autoimmune disease. Allison, however, had an entirely different idea. He had already developed an antibody that could bind to CTLA-4 and block its function. He now set out to investigate if CTLA-4 blockade could disengage the T cell brake and unleash the immune system to attack cancer cells. Allison and co-workers performed a first experiment at the end of 1994, and in their excitement, it was immediately repeated over the Christmas break. The results were spectacular. Mice with cancer had been cured by treatment with antibodies that inhibited the brake and unlocked anti-tumor T-cell activity. Despite little interest from the pharmaceutical industry, Allison continued his intense effort to develop the strategy into therapy for humans. Promising results soon emerged from several groups, and in 2010, an important clinical study showing striking effects in patients with advanced melanoma, a type of skin cancer. In several patients, signs of remaining cancer disappeared. Such remarkable results had never been seen before in the patient group. In 1992, a few years before Allison's discovery, Tasuku Honzo discovered PD-1, another protein expressed on the surface of T cells. Determined to unravel its role, he meticulously explored its function in a series of elegant experiments performed over many years in his laboratory at Kyoto University. The results showed that PD-1, similar to CTLA-4, functions as a T-cell brake, but operates by a different mechanism. In animal experiments, PD-1 blockade was also shown to be a promising strategy in fight against cancer. As demonstrated by Honzo and other groups, This paved the way for utilizing PD-1 as a target treatment for patients. Clinical development ensued, and in 2012, a key study demonstrated clear efficacy in the treatment of patients with different types of cancer. The results were dramatic, leading to a long-term remission and possible cure. For more than 100 years, scientists have attempted to engage the immune system in fight against cancer. Until the seminal discoveries by the two laureates, progress into clinical development was modest. Checkpoint therapy has now revolutionized cancer treatment and has fundamentally changed the way on how we view cancer can be managed. Do let us know on what your views of this year's Nobel laureates are. Would you have chosen some other contender? Is there an astounding piece of work that has gone unnoticed? Please leave your message in the comment section below. And while you're at it, I would like to shed light on one more important aspect. Why Indians have not been able to be a global leader in this area? Let me recall a few. C.V. Raman was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1930. Mother Teresa, Nobel Peace Prize, 1979. Amartya Sen, Economic Sciences, 1998. Kailash Satyarthi, Nobel Peace Prize, 2014. This is fine, but what about the field of physiology and medicine? In that category, we have Indian-born American laureates like Har Gobind Khurana, the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine, 1968. Ronald Ross, the Nobel Prize for Physiology and Medicine, born in Almora, British India. The striking question is, though so many aspirants enter into the research world every year, why do we still not have Indian Nobel laureates recognized for physiology and medicine? When we open this discussion to the audience, we hear about terms like biasness, politics, lack of dedication, unethical reasons, but is it true? Or is it the only reason why we are followers and not leaders? Please feel free to share your views on this. When we set out to truly discover the underlying truth, we figured that scientists win Nobel Prizes for a single path-breaking discovery. It is all right if he or she hasn't accomplished anything before or after this breakthrough. A Nobel Prize is not a lifetime achievement award. It is an award for a blazing trail. Nobel Prize winners open up completely new avenues that didn't exist before. In order to lead, it is essential to think out of the box. We may blame circumstances, but have we really tried our best? From a land which is known for ancient science and physiologies, blaming others seems a lame excuse. But after Raman, only one other scientist knocked on the Nobel doors hard enough. G.N. Ramachandran, the outstanding biophysicist who made fundamental contributions to our understanding of the protein structure. Ramachandran did not win a Nobel Prize, is now considered a significant omission on the part of Nobel Committee, but that is a different matter. It is our determination and focus that will help us concentrate all our efforts in our projects and turn them into unquestionable publications. That is the beginning of a pathway to being a pioneer in the field. If you find this session interesting and informative, do let us know and leave your valuable suggestions below, and stay tuned with your science partner Biotecnika to learn more about the amazing world of research. Thank you.